Danas poruka nosi naslov Poruka Efeskoj crkvi.
The message title this morning is The Message to the Church of Ephesians.
Kako izgleda širenje evanđelja danas?
How does the spreading of the gospel look like today?
Da li je propovedanje teško u uslovima koje mi danas imamo oko nas?
Are the conditions difficult to preach the gospel today?
Da li je ovo vreme teže od nekog drugog vremena koje je bilo u istoriji?
Is the period in which we're living more difficult than some period in the past in history?
Od kad postoji ova planeta, postoje reči koje se čuju iz generacije u generaciju.
As long as this planet has been in existence, there are some words that pass on from generation to generation.
Mladi kažu starim ovako, vi nas ne razumete.
The young people say to the old people, you do not understand us.
A stari kažu, u naše vreme to nije moglo tako.
And old people often say, in our time this could not be like this.
Mladi kažu, moramo da se pomerimo nekoliko koraka unapred.
Young people say, we need to move forward a few steps.
Stari često kažu, nekada se znao red i nije se moglo pomerati i mnogo je dobro sve funkcionisalo.
But the old people often say, back in the past, in the old days, it was good and we knew how to do it and it was the right way.
U kojoj grupi si ti?
In which group do you find yourself?
Da li misliš da je bolje bilo nekada?
Do you think it was better sometimes in the past?
Ili misliš da možemo da pomerimo nešto pa da bude još bolje?
Or do you think we can move and change something to be even better?
Da li misliš da je nekada bilo lakše?
Do you think it may have been easier in the past?
Ne znam, kad se stariji prisjećaju vremena u kom su oni živjeli, to je puno lepih emocija, da kažu, pa tad nije bilo toga, tad je bilo ovako i onako.
When all the people have fond memories of their past, they say, oh, but it was different back then.
A onda kad mi pričaju malo bliže, kažu da su na sabor morali idu biciklovima.
But then when we get talking a little bit more, they say that they had to attend the congress to have to get there by bicycle.
Zimi su morali da stavljaju plastične kese na noge da im se cipile ne ukaljaju od blata.
In winter, they had to put on a plastic covering over their feet so they don't get their feet all muddy.
Kada bi neko bio bolestan, lekar bi bio daleko ili bi retko kad dolazi u selo.
When someone was sick, the doctor was lived very far and would very seldom come to the village.
Da li dalje mislite da nekada bilo lakše?
But do you still think it was better and easier back then?
Ili možda mislite da je sada lakše?
Maybe it's easier today.
Da li uopšte poenta u tome da bude lakše?
Is the point even whether it's easier or not?
Kroz Sveto pismo možemo da vidimo kad god je narodu bilo lakše, narod nije bio dobar.
In the scriptures we can see that whenever it was easier for God's people, they were not so good and obedient.
Mislim da iz našeg života također možemo da zaključimo kad god nam je bilo jako dobro, nije baš bilo dobro za našu duhovnost.
And we may have come to the same conclusion in our lives when we had it easy, we might have not been so faithful.
Lično mogu da vam kažem da ne pamtim srčaniju ili srdačniju i funkcionalniju crkvu nego ona koja je bila za vreme rata 90-ih u Jugoslaviji.
I can personally tell you that I don't remember or know of a more wholehearted, sincere church than that it was back before the war.
Nikada pre ni posle moja matična crkva nije bila toliko aktivna i svi članovi su bili uključeni na neki način u službu.
And I just don't remember any other time when we were so active and effective together and working as one.
I onda opet postavljam pitanje, da li je poenta u tome da bude lakše?
And so again I ask the question, what is the point? Is it that things are easy?
Osim zapisa koje imamo o Hristovom životu u evanđeljima, postoji jedna posebna poruka koju je Isus uputio našoj crkvi.
Aside from the testimonies that we have from Jesus in the Gospels, we also have a special message that Christ has given to our church.
Znate, ranije kada smo bili mali, pa roditelji odlaze od kuće i onda napišu poruku.
You know the way it was when we were kids, when our parents would leave the house, they would leave us a message.
Sećate se toga?
Do you remember this?
I onda napišu na poruci.
And then they write as follows.
Uputstva, i tu su sadržali neretko poruke o ponašanju, šta trebamo da radimo.
And often that says that these are the instructions and often there were behavioral instructions of what we should do.
Lično u mom slučaju, moja majka bi napisala celu listu stvari šta ja treba da uradim da se ona vrati.
My personal case, my mom would write a whole list of what I needed to do before she comes back.
Da usisam kuću, da sredim sudove, da pobrišem pod i tako gomilu nekih stvari. Da ne bi slučajno bio besposlen.
A bunch of chores that I needed to do so that I wouldn't be idle.
I zatim bi stavilo jedno uputstvo, ne dirajte plin.
And then another instruction would say, do not touch the gas.
Ne igrate se sa noževima.
Do not play with knives.
I ima jedna naša poslovica, odnosno, kako da kažem, rečenica koja se često čuje, nož i viljuška i makaze, decu nakaze.
And there is a saying in our language that's familiar that goes, knives and forks can cause harm to children.
Tako da deci je to bilo zabranjeno.
And so children are forbidden to touch these.
Isus je otišao na nebo.
Jesus has gone to heaven.
Uputio je poruku, poslednju svoju poruku.
He has given us his final message.
Idite, govorite, propovedite, znamo veliki nalog
napravo. We know the great commission, go and preach the gospel to all nations.
Ali nedugo posle toga, Jovan na Patmosu dobija jednog posetioca, vrlo neočekivan.
But shortly thereafter, John on Patmos receives a visitor.
Da li znamo ko je posetio Jovana u zatvoru?
Do we know who visited John in prison?
Posetio ga lično Isus.
It was Jesus.
I kada pogledamo šta mu je rekao, vidimo da je to bila poruka koju on imao za crkve koje će slediti.
And we can see when we read in the Bible that this was the message that Jesus had for the churches.
I on Jovanu otkriva kroz tih sedam, kroz poruku sedam crkava, trodimenzionalno proročanstvo ili poruku u tri različite dimenzije.
And so we have this message to the seven churches, which is found in the book of Revelation, which contains three-dimensional message to God's people.
Prva poruka bila je odnosno prva ta dimenzija bila je usmerena tim fizičkim crkvama koje su se nalazile u Maloj Aziji.
The first dimension of this message from Jesus was a direct message for the physical churches, the seven churches which were then located in Asia.
Druga dimenzija bila je usmerena različitim vremenskim razdobljima kroz istoriju.
The second dimension is we find that these seven churches are for seven periods in Earth's history.
I treća dimenzija ove poruke.
And the third dimension of this message
je poruka koja može se nađe u poruci svakoj ovoj crkava lično nam.
Is the personal message that we can draw for ourselves individually.
E sad, ono što je jako zanimljivo, vidimo da Isus dolazi kod Jovana i kaže mu sledeće.
What's really interesting is we see Jesus coming to John and he tells him the following.
Kaže, napiši knjigu crkvama.
It says, write the book to the church.
E, upravo ovde se koristi reč knjiga ili pismo koje se odnosi, koje je napisano u jednini. Znači, ne različite knjige, nego jedna knjiga crkvama.
What's interesting to note here is that it's not a plural, so it's one book, write a book to many churches.
Siguran sam da smo često slušali o tome kako je poruka išla u sedam crkava.
I'm sure we've listened many times in the past about how this message spread to the churches.
Možda je neko rekao da je sedam crkava svaka dobila svoju poruku.
Maybe someone said that every church received their own letter or book.
Međutim, kada pažljivo čitate ovaj zapis u Otkrivenju, vidjet ćete da je pisana samo jedna knjiga.
However, if you read this carefully in Revelation, you'll see that only one book was written.
Pročitat ćemo prvo poglavlje 11. stih.
And so we'll read together chapter 1, verse 11.
Kaže, i što vidiš, napiši u knjigu. Ovde je u jednini u našem jeziku.
Koji stih?
Prvo poglavlje 11. stih. Otkrivenje 11.1. I što vidiš, napiši u knjigu i pošalji crkvama koje su u Aziji, Efes, Mirna, Pergam, Tijatira, Sard, Filadelfija, Laodikeja. Otkrivenje 1.1, da.
1.1.
Da. 1.11, izvini. 1.11.
Okay. Saying, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, and what you see, write in a book and send it to the seven churches which are in Asia, to Ephesus, to Smyrna, to Pergamos, to Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea.
Znači vidimo, koji god prevod da uzmete, šta god da pogledate, vidjet će da se knjiga nalazi u jednini, što znači da je pisao jednu knjigu.
So as you saw here, there was a single book, not a plural of many books, but just one book.
Zašto je to bitno i zašto toliko to naglašavamo da je bila jedna knjiga?
And why is this so important that there was only one book?
Bitno je zato što poruka ide u sve crkve i možda će iz svih tih poruka neko u nekoj crkvi dobiti nešto za sebe korisno.
What's important is that because the message for all the churches is going to all the churches, and so anyone finding themselves in those churches can draw a message for themselves also.
Nije jedno pismo napisao u sedam primjeraka pa poslao na sedam adresa.
He didn't write one book in seven copies and then sent them all.
Nije svakoj crkvi napisao ono što ta crkva treba da dobije. Mogao je Filadelfiji samo da pošalje ono što je Filadelfija trebala da primi, ali nije tako uradio.
He didn't write just a targeted message for that one church.
Zatim kaže šalje jedno pismo svim crkvama.
He sends one book to all the churches.
Zašto je to tako bitno? Ajde da pogledamo malo kontekst.
Let's have a look at the context a little bit better.
Da li postoji nešto konkretno vezano za Laodikeju?
Is there a message that's specifically for Laodicea?
Kaže Laodikeja mlaka.
It says that Laodicea is lukewarm.
Mi znamo da se poruka Laodikeje odnosi lično na nas.
We know that the message for the Laodiceans is a message for our time as well.
Da li smo mi svi mlaki vernici?
Are we all lukewarm members?
Ja bih vam rekao iskustvo koje moj deda imao, bio je čovjek uhapšen zbog toga što je prodavao Biblije.
I can tell you the experience of my grandpa. He was arrested because he was selling Bibles.
U današnje vrijeme imate u nekim zemljama muslimanski gdje je sveto pismo zabranjeno, gdje se dobije smrtna kazna zbog toga, ljudi ginu danas zbog toga.
There are today countries in the world, some Muslim countries, where the word of God is forbidden and you can die if you have the word of God.
Pradeda od mog dobrog drugara Tihomira je bio vezan rukama na leđima da visi u reci koji su polomili led, do pasa u ledu je bio okačen zbog svoje vere.
My friend's great grandfather had his hands tied behind his back and he was forced to go in a river where they broke the ice, it was that cold, up to halfway because of his faith.
Tako da je do pola bio u hladnom vazduhu koji je bio minus 3, 4, 5 stepeni, ne znamo, a dole je bio u vodi koja ledi, nekoliko sati.
So he was a few hours forced to be in this river, which was in minus temperatures, in the cold.
Ako živimo u vremenu Laodikeje, ja vas pitam, da li su onda ovi vernici bili mlaki vernici?
And so if we are living in this time of Laodicean church, were these members, these examples that I've given, lukewarm?
Da li bi bili hapšeni zbog Biblije, da li bi bili u ledenoj reci kažnjavani satima da su oni samo mlaki vernici?
Would they allow themselves to be arrested and to be forced into a freezing river if they were just lukewarm members?
Očigledno da oni uopšte nisu bili mlaki vernici.
It is clear that they were not lukewarm.
O čemu se radi? Poruka crkvama je data po njihovim glavnim karakteristikama.
You see, what we see here is that the messages to the churches are given according to their main characteristics.
I u današnje vrijeme možda glavna karakteristika naših crkava je da su mlake u odnosu na ove ostale.
And perhaps today the dominant characteristic today is that the churches are lukewarm.
Ali to ne znači da u našoj crkvi ima onih koji zaista gore za evanđelje.
But that does not mean that we don't have among us those who are burning and on fire for God.
Upravo zato Jovan napisao jedno pismo svim crkvama.
And for this very reason John wrote one book for all the churches.
U svakoj poruci ovim crkvama možda možeš naći nešto baš za sebe.
In every one of these messages to the seven churches we might find something for us individually.
U znacima vremena iz 903. godine Ellen White kaže:
In the signs of the times in the year 1903 Ellen White says the following.
Da će poruka koja je pisana sedam crkava u Maloj Aziji imati implikacije na ceo svet do kraja vremena.
That the messages to the seven churches that were given to Asia Minor will have an implication to all churches throughout all time.
Pismo upućeno u sljedeće gradove: Efes, Smirna.
And the book that was given to the following cities: Ephesus, Smyrna,
Pergam, Tiatira, Sard,
Pergamos and Thyatira,
Philadelphia i na kraju Laodikeja.
Sardis, Philadelphia and Laodicea.
I kada pogledamo na mapi ove gradove.
And when we see on a map these locations.
Otvorite Google pa pogledajte. Ovi gradovi su poređani upravo ovim redom. Išao je Efes, Smirna i ovako sve u krug do Laodikeje.
And you can see if you look at this on a map, you can Google it at home, that the cities were located so that they go in a circle.
Efes možete naći pod istim imenom.
In a circuit, and you can find these cities by their same names, Ephesus.
Onda ide današnji Izmir, to jest Smirna nekadašnja.
Smyrna can be found there, but that has a modern name.
Okay, i idemo sada na malo na ovaj grad, da vidimo kako izgledao taj Efes. Zašto je poruka ovom Efesu bila baš ova koja je data u otkrivenju?
And so this morning we want to talk a little bit about Ephesus and why it received the special message that it did.
Efes je bio četvrti najveći grad u Maloj Aziji.
Ephesus was the fourth largest city in Asia Minor.
U to vrijeme kada bi grad imao preko 15.000, to je bio veliki grad.
In those days when any city had more than 15,000 people, it was a big city.
Ovaj grad imao je 250.000 stanovnika.
And this particular city had 250,000 inhabitants.
Bio je veliki centar uticaja.
It was a big center of influence.
Imali su gimnazije, političke kuće.
They had educational and political institutions.
Hramove.
They had temples.
Trgovine.
Shops and markets.
Možda ćete se začuditi, ali oni su imali neke primitivne klima uređaje.
They also had some kind of primitive air conditioning.
Tako je. Imali su centralno grejanje po kućama.
They had a form of centralized heating in their
Zatim,
house.
Zatim imali su veoma zdravi i napredan grad. Uređen.
They had a very vibrant and healthy city.
Imali su jako veliku biblioteku.
They had a very big library.
Znate koja je najveća stvar bila u gradu?
Do you know what the biggest thing was about the city?
Najveća je bio hram boginji Artemidi.
The biggest thing in the city that you could find was the temple to the goddess Artemis.
Toliko poseban da je pored piramida u Gizi, visećih vrtova u Vavilonu, statue Zevsu i ostalih velikih čuda bio jedan od 7 svetskih čuda tadašnjeg starog sveta.
It was so big, this temple, that in those days, together with the pyramids and the temple of Zeus and so on, it was one of the 7 wonders of the world in that time.
Volio bih da vam kažem nešto vezano za taj hram. Vrlo interesantno.
I'd like to share with you some interesting things about this temple.
Prvo, hramu niste mogli lako da priđete bez određene kontrole, jer je vojska stajala oko hrama.
You couldn't get close to this temple without special controls. There was an army around stationed around the temple.
Zatim prva stvar, svi bogati su svoje zlato i blago i što god su imali vredno ostavljali u hramu, jer tamo niko to nije dirao.
All the rich people left their treasures of gold and their precious things in the temple as no one could touch them there.
Jel biste vi donali svo blago što imate u hram danas?
Would you today bring all of your treasure into the temple?
Bio je azil za sve kriminalce. Čak ni imperator nije mogao da izvuče nekoga iz hrama ako bi tu zatražio azil. Zamislite to.
This temple served as an asylum for criminals who happened to escape there, and even the emperor himself couldn't take people out of the temple if he wanted to.
Ako biste imali venčanje i zatražili ste da dobijete prostoriju za venčanje, oni bi vam u hramu našli prostoriju samo za vas.
If you had a wedding and wanted to find a room in the temple to hold your wedding, they would find that for you.
Umetnici, ako ste stvarali nešto svojim rukama, slikali, vajali ili nešto slično, mogli ste svoje umetničke radove da izložite, oni bi vam dali prostoriju za to.
Artists and creators who created some things were able to display them in the temple.
Ako ste bili putnik koji putuje i našao se u Efesu opljačkan, ostao bez novca, otišli biste u hram.
If you were a traveler and found yourself robbed in Ephesus and without money, you could go to the temple and find help there.
Oni bi vam dali nešto novca, dali vam prenoćište dok se snađete da krenete svojoj kući.
And they would offer you their accommodation and some money until you found your way back home.
Jel vam se sviđa ovaj hram?
Do you like this temple?
Mnogo dobrih osobina ima. Idemo dalje. Svaki građanin Rima imao je dužnost da posećuje hram.
Every citizen of Rome had the duty to visit this temple.
I ne samo da poseti, nego i da učestvuje u hramskim obredima.
And not just to visit, but also to participate in the ceremonies of the temple.
Također, oni su imali hramske obede. Imali su jelo zajedno, ručkove, večere.
They also had special banquets at the temple.
I prisustvovanje tome značilo bi da ste jeli hranu koja je bila iznošena pred idole.
And if you participated in this, it would mean that it was eating the food that was sacrificed to the idols in the temple.
Ovaj hram u okviru svoje službe imao je određeno seksualno zadovoljstvo koje ste također trebali da učestvujete kao članovi rimskog društva.
And part of the services offered at this temple was also forms of sexual pleasure.
Tako da ako biste bili član ove religije, nekako najbezbednije mesto, mesto sa svim mogućim zaštitama u smislu financija.
So if you were a member of this religion, this temple served to be kind of the most safe place.
Sve usluge koje ste mogli da dobijete kao zanatlije ili umetnici.
And it could offer you many services that you would need in life.
Bezbednost od nekoga ko vas juri.
Safety from oppression or...
Hranu, pomoć.
Food, help, shelter.
I sve ostale različite vrste zadovoljstva.
And many other kinds of pleasures were found in this place.
Imati takav jedan hram u gradu za hrišćane nije umalo značilo dobro.
And to have such a temple in the middle of the city was not a good thing for Christians.
Ako ste bili uspešni u svom poslu, zarađivali novac, bili biste član tog društva i ne biste lako mogli da prođete da ne budete u hramu.
If you were successful at your trade craft and lived in Ephesus, you needed to be part of the society of those in that temple.
Pitanje, da li biste mogli da napredujete i dalje ako ne biste odlazili u hram?
And if you did not participate in this temple, you wouldn't be able to succeed so well in your trade.
Nije bilo šanse za to. Čak i ako ste bili mali i ako niste puno zarađivali, jednom godišnje biste morali da donesete tamjan da dobijete potvrdu da ste rimski građanin.
And even if you were the smallest small business, you still needed to go there once a year to put some incense and to get a certificate that you are part of this.
Dobra vest u tome je da je Bog i u tom gradu imao svoje verne ljude.
And the good news about all this that even in that city God had his own faithful people.
I sada ponovo možemo da vidimo kako izgleda poruka ovoj Efeskoj crkvi.
And again now we can look at this message to the church of Ephesus.
I da sami sebe možda pitamo, da li je nekada bilo lakše ili je danas lakše?
And we can ask ourselves, was it really better back in the old days or is it better today?
Čitamo Otkrivenje 2, 2 do 4.
In Revelation chapter 2, verse 2 to 4.
Ova poruka upućena je znači anđelu Efeske crkve i kaže ovako.
And this message is sent to the angel of the church of Ephesus.
Znam tvoja dela i trud tvoj i trpljenje tvoje i da ne možeš snositi zlih. Iskušao si one koji govore da su apostoli i nisu i našao si ih lažne. Možeš pročitati drugi stih.
I know your works, your labor, your patience, and that you cannot bear those who are evil, and you have tested those who say that they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars.
I podneo si mnogo i trpljenje imaš i za ime moje trudio si se i nisi sustao.
And you have persevered and have patience and have labored for my name's sake and have not become weary.
No imam na tebe što si ljubav svoju prvu ostavio.
Nevertheless, I have this against you that you have left your first love.
Šta se dogodilo u Efeskoj crkvi?
What happened to the church of Ephesus?
Jedni su druge počeli da ispituju.
One group started questioning the other group.
Da li su ovi baš verni kako treba?
Are they really faithful as they should be?
Onda su ispitivali ove nove što su dolazili sa novim istinama.
Then they started to question those new arrivals who were coming with new truths.
Grčevito su se trudili da zadrže svoju veru.
They wanted to hold on to their faith.
A šta se dogodi kada jedni drugi ispitujemo i kada procenjujemo jedni drugi?
When we question and judge between one another, what happens?
Pa evo, poruka koju Isus uputio njima kaže ovako baš.
And this is the very message that Jesus gave them.
Dobro je što si ispitivao, ali si ljubav zaboravio.
It's good that you had questioned, but you left your first love.
Da li je ovo poruka samo crkvi u Efesu i crkvi koja je bila prva u prvom periodu istorije posle Hrista?
Is this just a message to the Ephesians in the first part of the earth's history?
Ili ima nešto što mi možemo da naučimo danas iz ove poruke?
Is there something that we can learn today from this message?
Naravno da ima.
Of course there is.
Ako i procenjujemo nove istine i neke vernike, da ne zaboravimo da zadržimo ljubav, jer je ljubav najbitnija.
If we are judging between new truths or new members, let us not forget to have love.
I kada neki bračni par dođe pred razvod,
and when a young couple come to the point where they need a divorce,
onda bračni savjetnik ili pastor koji priča sa njima vraća ih na početak njihove ljubavi.
Then what usually happens is that the marriage counselor or the pastor tries to take them back to the beginning of their love.
I onda pita kako si se zaljubio u tu devojku koja ti je zavrtela mozak.
And they ask him the questions, how did you then fall in love with this young lady?
A onda onako se možda sa blagim osmehom se seti toga.
And then he with a mild smile may say, oh, yeah, I remember how it was.
Onda pita devojku, kako se ti zaljubila u tog pametnog, lepog i zgodnog muškarca?
And then she'll ask the lady the question, how did you fall in love with this smart, handsome young man?
I onda pokušavaju da ih vrate na izvor te ljubavi, na početak.
He's trying to bring them back to the source of the beginning of their love.
Naš veliki savjetnik upravo to radi, vraća na početak.
And so our great counselor does the very same. He brings us back to the first love.
Kaže, nemoj da zaboraviš prvu ljubav.
And it says, never forget the first love.
Hajde da probamo i mi, kao i crkva u Efesu, da se vratimo prvoj ljubavi.
let's try together as a church also to come back to our first love.
Iako je naša glavna karakteristika kao crkve Laodikeje da imamo mlakost,
even though maybe our main characteristic of our time is to be lukewarm,
siguran sam da deo ove poruke može da se upotrebi upravo i na našu crkvu.
I'm sure that the part of this message that we are reading can be also applied to our church today.
I zato Jovan nije napisao svaku jednu poruku jednoj crkvi, nego jednu poruku, jednu knjigu svim ovim crkvama.
And that's why we also received one book, one message of the church.
Vratimo se prvoj ljubavi.
Let's come back to the first love.
Prva ljubav je celovita, prva ljubav je bezuslovna.
The first love is unconditional, it's wholesome.
Nekada je možda bilo teško i sada je teško.
Sometimes it used to be hard, but today is also hard.
Bez ljubavi je generalno teško.
Without love, it's the hardest.
Zato bih vas pozvao da napravimo razliku.
And so I'd like to invite you to make a difference.
Da poslušamo poruku koju je Isus uputio Efeskoj crkvi.
To listen to the message that Jesus gave to the church of the Ephesians.
Da imamo ljubav jedni prema drugima.
To have love for one another.
Da gajimo ljubav.
To foster love.
Jer Bog je ljubav.
Because God is love.
Nek vam Bog da blagoslov u tome. Amen.
May God bless you in this undertaking. Amen.